Let's go to the book, if you would, the book of Matthew's Gospel. We're going to start in chapter 16 of the book of Matthew's Gospel. Praise God, praise God. Verse 1, it says, "The Pharisees also with the Sadducees came and tempting him, desiring him that he would show them a sign from heaven." Everybody wants to know the sign of heavens and what's going on, when is the world, how long the world going to be here. Look what Jesus said to them. He says, "And he answered and said unto them, when it is evening, ye say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and lowering," meaning the clouds is low. You see those low-hanging clouds in the morning, you start saying, man, it's going to rain today. We smart enough to tell those weather signs. Then he tells you this after he recognized, and he's telling them, they want him to show them a sign, but he's telling them to be observant. Be observant. He said, now you watch the weather, but look what he said. "Oh, you hypocrites, you can discern the face of the sky, but can ye not discern the signs of the time? A wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after sign, and there shall no sign be given to it, but the sign of the prophet Jonas." This is very important to all of us. When we hear Jesus said, when you're wicked and you're in adultery, you can go on down to smoking dope, you can go on down to killing, you can go on to robbing, you can go on down to unfaithful lying. When you're in any of these things, you may seek to know the time to get right. But you're not going to get but one sign of the end. He said the only sign you're going to get is the same sign that Jonah gave to Nineveh. When Nineveh was walking in sin and God was preparing to destroy Nineveh, he sent a prophet to preach to them. This is the sign you're going to get. You're going to get a minister to tell you to get it right. Time is short, because you're not going to be able to see it on your own, because you're right in the midst of the changing of the society. You're with the change of the society. You ain't satisfied having sex with one woman. You ain't satisfied without using all kind of toys and all kind of junk. You ain't satisfied. You're going to be right in the midst with the generation. You'll never see the signs of the end. But the sign you will get is the sign of Jonah the prophet. Jonah went to Nineveh and preached to them, get right. So what God's going to give you, this is the sign he's going to give you. Get it straight. Now, righteous people that serve God will be able to observe the times of the end. Now, I know some of you don't believe Jesus. You believe you'll know the signs anyhow, even though you'll be wicked. You got to understand, he is not a liar. If I were you and I was wicked, I would say this thing will come as a snare upon me if I don't get my life right. If I was you, because I believe Jesus. That's why it says, whoever believe in him should not perish, because you're going to make the necessary steps that he instructs you in. I want to say that again. Whosoever believeth in him should not perish. Not whoever believe in him would not perish. It didn't say whoever believe in him would not. It said they should not. Meaning it's a difference in would not and should not. Should not and would not is two different. I should not go to get drunk. But should not go get drunk don't mean I didn't go get drunk. Should not mean is something you should not perish, but it doesn't mean that you would not perish. When you would not go get drunk, that's when you can say, I don't care how much I'm tempted, I ain't going. Then you would not. So stop taking should not perish and putting would not perish in there. You're messing with the scripture. It says should not perish, and it did not say would not perish. Straighten that up anyway. Straighten that language up. If you believe in him, I agree with that. There's no way you should perish because you're going to do what he said do. You're not going to follow these religious teachers. I hear them all the time. Believe in your dream. Your dream gonna come to pass. Stop preaching. Let's wait a minute. Let's listen at this, what you're telling them people. Their dream gonna come to pass. Dream come to a multitude of business. Many of them rascals out there dreaming they've been sleeping with other folks' wives. They ain't got no dream about heaven because they ain't doing heaven deed. When you dream you was in fire. Yeah, your dream will come to pass. Don't dream for the dreams of Joseph and you don't live the life of Joseph. Don't let somebody go and pick Joseph out and tell you, Joseph's dream came to pass. Yeah, Joseph had a life that gave him heavenly dream. Your dreams is that you was running. Your dream, your wife caught you. You sit there and look at me all you want to. But these preachers want to make you believe you're going to fall in it. Well, if everybody's dream come to pass, why didn't Joseph's brother's dream come to pass? They wanted to get rid of Joseph. That was their dream. Why their dream didn't happen? Because God didn't let them take him away. And why they dreamed they wanted to be the head and God didn't let it happen? Because they didn't have the life that God supported their desire. If you want your hope and desire to come to pass, remember every man will be rewarded according to his works. That's what the scripture says. I'm going to take my time this morning. I ain't going to hold you long. Hallelujah. We're going to go over here, if you would, to the book of Hebrews, chapter 12 and verse 14. We're going to start right there. Hallelujah. Do you love him? Praise the name of Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. It says, follow peace with all men and holiness without, no man shall see the Lord. Now, this Bible is telling you if you don't live holy, nobody shall see the Lord. If no one live it, no one get there. Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God. Now, this shows you that you can have the grace of God and fail with it. Fall down, wind up not getting what you thought because you can let it go. Angels were in heaven and let go their habitation. So it's not that you got something signed, sealed, and delivered. You got to maintain a life. God will forgive you. I don't want to take away that. The scriptures tell you that. He will forgive you of sin, but forgiveness is allowing you a chance to take the test over. Let me say something to you. I mentioned to you earlier. It's all right if I talk to you real softly today. Heaven is a place where there's no hurt, no pain, no sorrow. Everybody agree with that. Well, what if your ex-brother-in-law make it there and he's been beating on your sister? He shot at your mama. All he had to do was say, I confess the Lord, and he's there. I forgave him. No, he didn't have to change his life, nothing. Well, now heaven just brought on the scene a man that's filled with bitterness, self-centeredness, character, personality, that is contrary to God. So I guess God's going to have to forgive him in heaven, right? After he slapped you up there. So somebody going to cry in heaven then. Trying to make you think, people. Don't let these preachers lie to you. Now, I want to let you know clearly. Your course of action that you do has nothing to do with your physical structure and appearance that we look at. This has nothing to do with my, this is how you can identify me. But this has nothing to do with the man, the type, the personality that this man radiates. It is my soul and my spirit inside of me that directs my body. That's what's going to go to heaven. This body of all of us is going back to the dirt. That's what's going to go to hell, your soul. And I'm going to tell you why. So you think I'm going to preach to y'all in heaven and you're going to repent up there and get right? You have got to do that now. Don't think you can change locations and you get right. Okay, I take you, set you over in London. That's going to make you stop looking for drugs? Well, if you think that'll make you stop looking for drugs, I counsel you to get you a plane ticket to London today. I help you. Get on over there. If it's going to take cussing out your mouth, well, you figure if I go to heaven, I'm going to change. No, you're not. You're the same man. It is not God being lack of mercy and lack of compassion or lack of care why you can't make it. It's God knowing that this type of spirit who you are, he would take that into glory. When you know anything, you'll have siding and secretarial stuff. You'll have racism. You'll have bitterness right in heaven. That's why He cannot bring you there. But His love is so for you, He can forgive you now, give you a spirit and power to change you so it'll guide you and make a new creature out of you. The process that I went through, brothers and sisters, you have to do the same. I humbled myself and came to the altar and asked God to help me. I let the preacher put his hand on me, said, God, deliver him. Or my pride wanted me to sit in my seat, didn't want nobody to know I needed help. But regardless, if somebody don't know I need help, you're not in this to prove nothing to anybody. You have got to get it right now. Hallelujah. Let's go over here and let's read, if you would, 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Let's go to verse 2. For he said, I have heard thee in an acceptable time. What God is saying in this passage, I will hear you at an appointed time. I'm going to hear your cry and help you. In the day of salvation have I succored thee. Mean I'll help you in the day of salvation. Now, Paul is quoting this scripture from the book of Isaiah, where God was letting Israel know, don't wait till you die here and start trying to ask for help. I'm going to get you and I'll save you in the day of salvation. But now you got a bullet in your chest and you never change the way you live. You're dying, you had a car wreck, you're on the ground, you know you're leaving, and all of a sudden you haven't lived nothing right. You just want God to just excuse everything and bring you into glory. He quoted this from the book of Isaiah 49. Now you would say, you know how I have to live, because all of y'all judge preachers. Every one of you said, oh, preacher ain't right here, living right here. But the bad thing about it, why you don't judge your own self how you live it? Don't believe in no preacher. You believe in a preacher. You don't believe in a preacher. Preacher do everything. What you ought to be worrying about is where you are. And I'm going to tell you something. I'm concerned for you. That's my duty and that's my love for you. But I don't want you saved more than I do myself. I promise you. I want to be saved more than I want you saved. And I don't take that offense. I want you to get there. But I'm trying to get there. I'm going to tell you something, brother. Why he mean like that? I tell you what, if you wanted to get to a basketball game and all the seats are being sold out and you were ready to say, you wouldn't want to skip over you and somebody else get their seat? If you got to get on the bus to go somewhere and you need to get there and about 10 people came up after you, you ain't so kind, you want them to get ahead of you and you stay. This is my seat. I was on here first. But I tell you what, that's how I am with my heaven. I ain't letting you get ahead of me. I ain't giving this up for nobody. I don't come too far. Have people a lot of time tell me, Bishop, just don't change. They don't know, man. I done been through those changing times where I was on having struggled and stuff. Man, I'm so focused now because I know I'm coming down to the end. And I know all of us need to know we're coming to an end. I'm telling you. But here he says, I've heard you. Let's read it from Isaiah so you may understand what this writer is talking about. Isaiah 49, verse 48. Thus said the Lord, in an acceptable time have I heard thee. Please listen to that, Christian people. In an acceptable time, I heard you. And in the day of salvation have I helped thee. Now here he is saying, I will help you in a day of salvation. Let us all in the church, I want all our members to know what salvation is. Most of you all know because you've heard me. But I want to reinforce what salvation is. The word salvation means more than just getting saved from sin. Salvation, the word salvation means the acute dynamic act of snatching one from a dangerous pearl or sword by force snatching them. That's what salvation is. Meaning when you can't help yourself, a force or a power, which Paul calls it grace, comes into your life and change you from a lifestyle, bring you to safety. This is salvation. Pharaoh's army was behind Moses trying to get them in Israel. They was at the Red Sea. The sea water has to be 200, 300 feet deep. Here they, Pharaoh's army behind them in two mountains on both sides. They caved in. They can't go forward. Pharaoh coming at them to kill them. Moses told Israel, stand ye still, set ye still today. Today, you will see the salvation of God. He was not talking about they was going to go to heaven. He was talking about God with his power was going to step in there where they couldn't help themselves and make a way out of no way for them to get to safety. That's what salvation means. When the salvation of your soul means you cannot change yourself from what you are. You tried stop drinking. Your buddies came by, you're back in it again. You tried to get rid of the drugs when you know anything. The urge came when you got depressed and down. You had an argument with your wife or your husband. You went back looking for the drug boys. You need salvation. You don't want to commit adultery because you know it might cause death, AIDS, lose your family. But you know anything, that urge come, the boyfriend call, the girlfriend call. There your little heart just a pumping. You need God's salvation. He'll give it to you. That comes free. You don't have to pay him no money for it. You ain't got to sow no seed. Ain't that good? You ain't got to sow no seed to get saved. You don't even have to have a seed in his Savior. Shout glory to God. He said, blessed are the poor, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Shout glory to God, somebody. But he said, whosoever call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So he said, in the day of salvation, I will help you. Hallelujah. Now, so let's go back over into 2 Corinthians. I'm not going to hold you long. 2 Corinthians. Praise the name of Jesus. Chapter 6 again. For he said, I've heard thee in the time accepted. Now, that's why when you read the Bible, saints, always know when you hear a read a term in the Bible and it says, he said, or it said, God said, or it said, thus said the Lord in the New Testament, anytime you hear that phrase, he said, the Lord said, or thus said the Lord, it's always a scripture in the Old Testament that's making that statement. Always a scripture in the Old Testament that's making that statement when it said the Lord said or the Spirit spoke. It's written in the scriptures. So I just read you the scriptures what this man is using thousands of years later. I've took people to the scriptures and they're going to tell me that was old time. Let me tell you something, brothers and sisters. These scriptures don't get old and vanish away. They don't do that. Let me tell you something. There are New Testament teaching that shows us that through the power of God in our lives that will bring us into the love of God with all our heart, all our soul, and all our strength, and all our mind, and loving our neighbor as ourselves, when we do those completely from our hearts, we will fulfill everything written over here. It will comprise all of it by fulfilling those commandments there. But it's not disannulled that you do not have to believe it or obey it again. Hallelujah. Now we're talking about the end of time, and we're talking about giving God and not doing things that are vain. But I let our lives and our works and our commitment be according to his specification. Just say you have to pass class in school, to get out of high school, college. You got to have a certain amount of credits, credit hours. Do you think because you, what if you don't have the credit hours? But you turn around and bring your teacher a Santa Claus. See? She ought to give you that grade, huh? What about you driving 100 miles an hour and when the police stop you, you give him that heart for the, this is Valentine's Day. Here you go. We know that doesn't work in society, but why we make God silly? I know what you think. God forgives. He forgives everything. He forgives. All right. He forgive. Well, what judge? God know you can't be perfect. God know you can't be perfect. Ain't nobody be perfect. All right, go rob from Walmart. Just go steal a bag of potato chips. And let the police take you to the judge. And tell the judge, now I'm going to ask you something, judge. You know you ain't perfect. Ain't nobody perfect. Hello. Why we respect the judges, we respect the Senate, but we have no respect for God's laws. It's just a little old bag of potato chips. I don't care if it was that penny gone. You walked out of it without paying it, you're going to stand before a judge and he don't let you, it makes his law of none effect. The greatness about judges, they have clemency in courts. They will give you probation. Probation is not that you are relieved of the crime. Probation is that they give you a chance to get it right and do things right. And they don't charge you for it. God himself, when he forgives you, he will forgive every one of you that come to the altar today. But that lasts as long as you keep that sin out of your life. It don't mean you can keep on doing it. Keep on getting it. Let me finish this here. Hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's go over here, and we're going to read here in the book of, as we get ready to close. I'm getting ready to close. I'm going to let y'all go early today. Now, you see this church, don't they want me to preach for hours. Hallelujah. I'm going to. If the Lord be willing, I'm going to let you go early. I'm going to go here to the book of Revelation, if you would. We're going to chapter 20 of the book of Revelation. And we're going to pray with you. Hallelujah. Chapter 20 of the book of Revelation. We're going to start here at verse 11. And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, whose face the earth and the heavens fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. That means after this life, after you have died, your soul one day will stand before God, and those books will be opened. And the dead shall be judged out of those things written in the books. Use the term books. So that means you can't just take one scripture. He didn't say the dead would be judged out of Romans 10. No, books. The dead will be judged out of the things written in the books. How? Not according to what you call grace, but according to their works. All of us will be judged out of those things written in the books, according to our works. When shall this thing happen? And it goes on to say, and death and hell was cast into the fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast in the lake of fire.